This is Dr. Max Schultz, pastor of the Heritage Baptist Bible Church in Walnut Grove, Minnesota. It is our privilege to be with you now for this half hour, and we hope that you have your Bibles out and you're ready to follow along, because that's the only way that we learn the Word of God is to give it out and you take it in. We'll be back in just a moment. It is so good to be with you again this Sunday morning, as it is each Sunday morning at the same time, and we count it our privilege to come into your homes and spend this time with you. If you have your Bibles, we would invite you now to get them out and be ready to turn with us here as we continue now our Bible study. This will be our last message now on the subject of foreknowledge, predestination, election, choosing, and so forth. We have not went extensively into choosing and so forth and foreknowledge in that because we begin to find out here, when God loved the world, we find out that this basis here eliminates all of the rest, which are built upon the philosophy, human philosophy here, of the extreme Calvinist. We find out again, according to what they teach, is summed up into one word, which is the word tulip. Total inability, the unconditional covenant, and then the limited atonement, irresistible grace, and then perseverance of the saints. Now, we're going to take in our last message here this morning and study on the subject here about the irresistible grace. That is, the hyper-Calvinists say, therefore, that if you're predestinated to be saved, you cannot resist the grace of God. You're going to be saved anyway. There is not anything you can do to resist it. But we find this is not the teaching of the Bible whatsoever. We find out that you can resist the grace of God. We find out that you can sit in your seat and hear the invitation and reject it, as many, many people have done. Maybe you listening this morning, you're saved now, but there have been many times when you've sat and been convicted by the Holy Spirit and resisted that and not adhered and put your faith in Jesus Christ. Now, grace, God's grace is not irresistible. Now, the Scriptures show that enlightened, convicted men do resist God. They do throw out the grace of God. Men who could be saved, who are set apart by the blood of Christ, men who are bought, resist the Holy Spirit. God's grace is offered to all, but is not irresistible as Calvin taught. One of the 5 points now, as we've said, of this man-made philosophy of extreme Calvinism is the doctrine of irresistible grace. And again, we might remind you by this term Calvin meant, and the hyper-Calvinists today mean, that God intended for only a limited number of people to be saved, that the atonement of Christ paid for the sins of only this limited few, and this is their doctrine of the limited atonement, as extreme Calvinists call it. That is, that those who are predestinated to be saved cannot resist the grace of God, cannot reject the Savior, but are certain to be saved. For this reason, extreme Calvinists are not generally burdened about soul winning, since, they say, the grace of God is irresistible. So if we can show that the Bible teaches that men do resist the grace of God, do resist the moving and the conviction of the Holy Spirit, we have proved that extreme Calvinism is simply not true, that it is unscriptural, that it is a man-made philosophy contrary to the Bible. But the Bible and human experience alike prove that men do resist the Spirit of God. They do throw out divine grace. Therefore, some could be saved who are not saved, and the atonement is for all, for everyone. The Lord said in 2 Peter, he said, I'm not willing any should perish, but that all should come to repentance or a change of mind. Now, if you have your Bibles, turn with me, if you will, to the 7th chapter of the book of Acts, and we find Deacon Stephen, a Spirit-filled man of God, speaking before the Sanhedrin and the Jewish elders. This Spirit-filled man said, notice here, if you will, in verse 51 and 52, ye stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. Now, I'd underline that word resist there because it says they do. As your fathers did, so do ye. Which of the prophets have not your fathers persecuted, and they have slain them which showed before of the coming of the just one? of whom you have been now the betrayers and the murderers. You see, to these Jewish leaders, Stephen said in Acts chapter 6, verse 7, ye do always resist the Holy Ghost. So here were people, some of whom had seen Jesus and they'd heard him preach, and others who had heard Peter, the apostle at Pentecost, others who had heard Stephen and the other Spirit-filled men preaching with great power, so that the word of God increased and the number of the disciples multiplied in Jerusalem greatly, and a great number and company of the priests were obedient to the faith. And what had these done? They were stiff-necked. They were uncircumcised in heart and ears. That is, they were stubborn in their rebellion against God. They were deliberately uncircumcised in heart and ears, remaining unconverted. And this resistance against the Holy Spirit went to such length that as they heard Stephen preach, they were cut to the heart, and they gashed on him with their teeth. And then they took him out of the city, and they stoned him, and they killed him. You see, men do resist the Holy Spirit. These particular men had done so year after year, under great moving of the Holy Ghost and great conviction of the Holy Spirit. And then we find out that Stephen said, as your fathers did, so do ye. And so Stephen says that all the way from Abraham through the history of the Jewish nation down to the time of Christ, and those same Jewish elders, unconverted Jews, had resisted the Holy Spirit and the grace of God. Now we find must believe, taking the Word of God at face value, that God calls people who do not come. God convicts people who will not change their mind. God's Spirit moves people to be saved, but they will not be saved by their own choice. One of these same Jewish leaders who heard Stephen speak was Saul of Tarsus. Oh, how he hated this new sect of Christians, and he really did. And now with that hate flaming in his heart and the zeal of Judaism that he had set out to arrest Christians at Damascus. You see, Paul, up to this time, was resisting the Holy Spirit so much so that the latter God said to him, it is hard for thee to kick against the pricks, in Acts chapter 9, verse 5. So people do kick against the pricks of God's Holy Spirit. People do resist the call of God. People do resist God's grace and do throw out God's offer of mercy. And that means that those who are not saved could have been saved. Those who reject Christ could have accepted him. God offers mercy to those who will have it. Those who go to hell go not because God wanted them to go there, nor because they were predestinated to go to hell, but they go to hell because they would not give heed to the moving of the Holy Spirit upon their hearts and their minds, and they would not change their mind when God commanded them to do so. They would not follow the light that God gave them. You might be listening this morning. Maybe the Holy Spirit of God has convicted you. Maybe you've been in church. Maybe you were there a few Sundays ago. Maybe you've been listening to some radio broadcast, or you've seen a religious program on television. And maybe you've just laughed at it. But way down deep inside, there's something stirring you saying, listen, you better listen to what that man's saying. You better listen to what that preacher over the radio or watching him on television or sitting in church. Even though you might be laughing on the outside and doubting on the outside, way down something or saying, listen, whoever you are, you better listen to what that man's saying. Listen to what the Bible says. And then we find again in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 29, we find a clear statement that men resist God, that sometimes men who are convicted and moved to get saved will not be saved. I hope if you're listening and you're not saved, you've never received Christ as your Savior, then I'll tell you this right now, God's not willing you should perish, and the Holy Spirit will convict you that you do need to put your trust in Jesus Christ. Satan will be there too. He'll tell you that you can never live a good enough life, and that's deceiving because none of us are perfect. Even a Christian after they're saved, they're not perfect. And no one expects you to be perfect, because even after we're a Christian, we sin and we've got to go to the Lord Jesus and get restored back to fellowship. But I know this much, the Holy Spirit wants you to be saved. You don't have to do anything to be saved except believe in the Lord Jesus Christ. Trust God's Son as payment for your sin, and God said you'll never perish but have everlasting life. And then we find, read again in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 28 and 29, reading together, He that despised Moses' law died without mercy under two or three witnesses. Oh, how much sore punishment, suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy who hath trodden underfoot the Son of God and hath counted the blood of the covenant, wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. Despite unto the Spirit of grace. First, I'd like for you to notice that God says the damnation of a lost sinner is illustrated by the stoning of rebels against the Mosaic law in the Old Testament. Those who sin willfully, that's in verse 26 now, who sin willfully after they have received the knowledge of the truth, are ready for judgment for rejecting the truth. Now notice that the sin mentioned is willful sin, and this involves a certain freedom of the will to sin or not to sin. Now, I'm not speaking now of the tent in the carnal nature. I'm not speaking about that. But in the actual choice of right or wrong, the choice of receiving Christ or rejecting him. So you see, a willful sinner under the Mosaic law at the mouth of two or three witnesses was stoned. But then God warns in verse 29 of how much more sore punishment. Suppose ye, shall he be thought worthy who have trodden underfoot the Son of God, hath counted the blood of the covenant, wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing, and hath done despite unto the Spirit of grace. Now, notice, if you will, first of all, we find out here they have trodden underfoot the Son of God. That's the first thing there. The second thing is, such a man has counted the blood of the covenant, wherewith he was sanctified an unholy thing. He did this himself. Now, we find out that this may mean either two things. First of all, it may mean that every lost sinner is in some sense sanctified by the death of Christ, that is, potentially set apart for God, since Christ is potentially the Savior of all men, but specifically of them that believe, as we are expressingly told in 1 Timothy 4:10. Then the blood of Jesus potentially sets apart every sinner in the world for God. That is saying no more than 1 Corinthians 15:22, for as in Adam all die, even so in Christ shall all be made alive. Every poor sinner is bought by the blood of Jesus. He is the propitiation for the sins of the whole world in 1 John 2:2. Or we find this, some will think that the blood of the covenant wherewith he was sanctified refers to the blood of the animal sacrifices which Jews gave. They think that every Jew was thus sanctified or set apart by a covenant of blood. But if so, this does not change the essential meaning. If every Jew was set apart by bloody sacrifices, then those bloody sacrifices typified the blood of Christ, and the blood of Christ surely went as far as the blood of bulls and goats. Now, this scripture plainly teaches that the blood of Jesus Christ has set apart every sinner for salvation. Some do not accept that salvation that is offered, but Jesus said, and we find, is the Savior of the world. Although not all the world will take him as Savior, Jesus is the propitiation of our sins, and not for ours only, but also for the sins of the world. Although some people do not accept the blessed gift that is given, so here the Scripture is teaching that the blood of Christ has purchased people for salvation who do not take his wonderful salvation plan by faith in Christ. Now, we find out a third thing the Scripture says about such a sinner who rejects Christ, and that is, he has done so despite unto the Spirit of grace. You see, the blessed Holy Spirit who calls the sinner and whom he resists is insulted and abused by the Christ-rejecting sinner. Listen, friend, when you go to hell, you must remember that you have trodden underfoot the Son of God. You must remember that when you go to hell, you're counted the blood of Jesus shed for you as an unholy thing. In hell, you must remember that you were called and pleaded with and convicted and enlightened by the Holy Spirit, but you insulted that Spirit, and you did it despite unto the Spirit of grace. Now, we're talking here about the grace of God, which is so freely offered to sinners by the Holy Spirit. And sinners resist and reject that grace of God and insult the Holy Spirit who pleads with them, as the Word of God teaches. Now, we find that every lost sinner could be saved. The death of Christ made the requirement and paid for his sins. The precious blood is a holy thing, which would pay the entire debt. The Holy Spirit of God calls in grace but the sinner refuses. This scripture does not teach irresistible grace, but it teaches the grace of God offered to all men so that all could be saved and all ought to be saved. You're listening right now. You have an opportunity to receive the Lord Jesus Christ. You most assuredly do. God loves you. He will not make you. He will not stand over you with a sludgehammer and beat it into you. No one will do that. Neither will a preacher. But I know this much. If you have any common sense at all and God offers you something freely, absolutely free, and it's a free gift. In Ephesians 2:8-9, we are told, by grace are we saved through faith, that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Now, turn with me, if you will, to 2 Peter in chapter 2, and we'll follow on down here, or we'll give this to you, and you can look this up later if you wish. We find out in 2 Peter chapter 2, we find out that this is speaking upon a discussion of false prophets. The whole 22 verses are on this subject, and the chapter starts off with this statement, but there were false prophets among you, also among the people, even as there shall be false teachers among you, who privily shall bring in damnable heresies, even denying the Lord that brought them, and bring upon themselves swift destruction. You see, these false teachers bring in damnable heresies, denying the Lord that bought them. Now, here's a strange statement, that even false teachers are bought by the blood of Jesus Christ. Now, this chapter goes on to great detail to show that these false prophets are lost people, certain of the judgment of God. Verse 3 says to them, whose judgment now of a long time lingereth not, and their damnation slumbereth not. And you see, the rest of the chapter tells us how God, who spared not the angels of sin, but cast them down to hell, or Tartarus, will not spare these false teachers. And then in verse 5, it tells us that as God destroyed the ungodly in the flood, so will he destroy these false teachers. And then in verses 6 to 8, he tells us as God destroyed Sodom and Gomorrah, so will he also destroy these false teachers. You see, these false teachers are described in verse 12 as natural brute beasts, made to be taken and destroyed. Verse 17 speaks of these false teachers as wells without water, clouds that are carried with a tempest, to whom the mist of darkness is reserved forever. These false teachers are ungodly men who will go to hell. They are men even denying the Lord who brought them. Quote. Now, notice again, these men are denying the Lord who bought them. I don't think anything could be more clearly shown than these men are included in the atoning death of Christ. They are included in the grace of God, which would save everyone. But they resist the grace of God. They reject the call of the Spirit. They exercise the freedom of their wills to reject Christ and to be lost. Men do resist the will of God and go to hell who could have been saved. And that shows the folly of this man-made philosophy of the hyper-Calvinist. It shows the falsity of this human doctrine of limited atonement. This human doctrine of irresistible grace, this doctrine that some are foreordained to reprobation, as others are foreordained to be saved. I do not need to call your attention to the fact that those of us who are saved, in some cases, had resisted the call of God or resisted the conviction of the Holy Spirit. We find in Acts chapter 24, verse 25, we are told how that Paul reasoned, this is after Paul was saved, of course, but he reasoned of righteousness, temperance, and judgment to come, and then we find out here that the governor Felix trembled. No doubt, the Holy Spirit of God convicted Felix and spoke to his heart. He waited for a convenient season, and we suppose kept waiting and waiting and waiting and went on to hell. But he cannot say that he might not have been saved. He can never say that the Spirit of God did not call him, did not convict him, and did not show him his need. When Paul spoke to him, we find out that he did shake. He trembled. Something did it. Something convicted him. And then a little later in Acts, we find out that when Paul appeared before King Agrippa, that's King Agrippa II, we find out here that when he witnessed unto King Agrippa, Agrippa said, almost, Paul, thou persuadest me to become a Christian. This great king, who was the son of the King Agrippa there in Acts chapter 12, who killed James. This was his son over here in Acts later on here. And we find out when Paul witnessed to him, gave his testimony, he said, Paul, he said, almost thou persuadest me to become a Christian. Now, there was something there convicting him about receiving the Lord Jesus Christ as his personal Savior. There was something there. And we find out here, he was convicted enough to say, almost, Paul, almost. And you know what? There are some of you listening out there this morning that have almost put your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. But for one reason or another, for some deceivableness of Satan that has fed you some kind of lie in order to divert your eyes off of Christ, and yet you're still unsaved. Well, who knows? You never know from one day to the next who's going to be here, how long we're going to live. No one knows that. But I know this right now. You can be saved and know for sure that you have a home in heaven if you'll receive the Lord Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. You don't have to do a thing. Just realize you've sinned as I have, and that Jesus Christ died to pay for that sin. And God said, if you'll just accept my payment, the Lord Jesus, by faith, I'll tell you where you'll never go. You'll never perish. And then I'll tell you what you do have. You have everlasting life.
If you're listening today and you do not know that you have eternal life, you're not absolutely sure that you're going to heaven when you die, then here's how simple that it is. God has concluded we all have sinned, that you and I. God has also said that he loves the sinner. And we find out in Romans 5:8, God commendeth his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And then in John 3:16, God loved the world. He loves you. He gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him would never perish, but have everlasting life. If you realize you're a sinner and Christ is a wonderful Savior, and he died on that cross to save you from spending eternity in hell, so you could have a home in heaven with him. He bought your right to live with him for all time and eternity. All he asked you to do is believe the record God gave of his Son, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved. Well, we hope that you'll take time to write us. We'd love to hear from you. If you're in the area of Walnut Grove, we'd love to have you come to church. Our morning worship service begins at 10, from 10 to 11. Love to invite you to our services. Our mailing address is the Heritage Radio Bible Class, Post Office Box 573, Walnut Grove, Minnesota, and our zip code is 56180.
Remember our website again. It is www.heritagebbc.com.
Until next week at the same time, may the Lord richly bless you as we ever pray, even so come, Lord Jesus.